And we wrote down a form of the metric that took the boy the form, and now I'll stick to Landau-Lifschitz notation. So in general, we could write it as h of r t dr squared plus k of r t sine squared theta d phi squared d theta squared plus l of r t d t squared plus a of r t dr dt. Okay, we argued this last class. We changed the names of the functions. That doesn't matter. Okay, now to proceed. You see, theta and phi have physical meaning. Meaning they are the coordinates on a round two sphere. We've used the spherical symmetry to distinguish coordinates on the two sphere. However, the coordinates r and t are so far completely arbitrary. This tells, yes?
There are four functions because there are 10 in the metric. So 4 are 1 because of and 2 from the
two from?
2 from the symmetric. So, is that correct?
Okay, let's see how we would count. Suppose we looked at r, t, theta and phi. The 10 functions that you have are the various elements of this matrix. Since it's symmetric, we'll just look at this and not have things here. Okay? Now, what elements do we have? We have dr squared, we have dt squared. Now, we have a d theta squared and a d phi squared. We have no d theta, d phi. All of these three have been replaced by 1. That is the coefficient behind this guy. Okay? And we're not going to allow anything that is cross between r and theta, r and t and phi and psi. Okay? So that kills 4 here. Those are the cross terms between r and theta, r and phi, t and theta, t and phi. And we've killed the two additional ones here. By saying that of the three possibilities in the theta phi space, that's just 1. Okay, so that's the 10 minus 4 minus 2. Okay, but you see, so far what we've done is not work with any particularly distinguished coordinate in the RT sense. Now, you can ask what coordinate redefinition freedom do we have in our hand? Of course, we've got full coordinate redefinition freedom, but if we do any redefining of involving theta and phi, that will change this distinguished part of the metric to something else. We'll be using some different coordinates on the sphere. We don't want to do that. We want to use particular coordinates on the sphere. Okay? Any coordinate freedom that if we redefine r and t in a theta and phi dependent way, it will give you spurious dependences on theta and phi. That's not convenient for our problem. So we want to keep this form of the metric. So what we are going to try to do is to ask, what coordinate freedom do we have left that preserves this form of the metric? Okay? And the answer to that question is obvious. Can somebody tell me what it is? Rotations just don't change the metric at all. But we want to look at more generally coordinate transformations that will preserve this form of the metric but change the values of these functions, a, k, l, and r. Scaling of r, that's one possibility, but that's a very minor possibility.
functional scale.
Right. Any field redefinition which is R is equal to some function of R prime and T prime. And T is equal to another function of R prime and T prime. Okay? Well, that will change what this particular function is, just by putting what R is as a function of it. And we'll change this part of the metric. But we'll preserve this form, clearly. Okay? So by adopting this form, we have essentially broken our diffeomorphism invariance down to diffeomorphism invariance in two dimensions. Okay. So now we have this coordinate redefinition freedom of R and T, and we can use that to further simplify our metric. Okay. So now we're going to do two things. The first thing we're going to do is to... since we've got two functions in our hand, two coordinate freedoms in our hand, we can use it to set two of these functions to something nice. Okay? The first thing we're going to do is to set this guy to zero. And the second thing we're going to do is, after having done that, adopt a convenient definition of what R is. So we will just set K is equal to R. Okay? So we use coordinate redefinition ambiguity to say that our new R coordinate is whatever came behind this thing. The new R coordinate square is whatever came behind this. So that is, that has now given a physical interpretation to this R coordinate. The R coordinate, 4 pi times R square, is the size, is the physical size of the two sphere at that location of R. Physical area of the two sphere at that location of R. Yeah? So we use a physical criterion to give meaning to R. And then we use the further field redefinition ambiguity, the T field redefinition ambiguity after that, to get rid of this term. Okay? Now you could ask, when you always do that, postpone such questions. I mean, certainly in local patching, there are topological obstructions with postpone such questions. Okay? So, what this leaves us with is a metric of the form ds squared is equal to, and then we do some renaming again to stick to Landau-Lifshitz conventions. Ds squared is equal to e to the power nu dt squared minus r squared d theta squared plus sine squared pi d pi squared minus e to the power lambda d r squared. Well, we've just taken sine squared theta. And we've just renamed these functions. Okay? Whatever comes behind dt squared, we've called e to the power nu. Whatever comes behind dr squared, we've got e to the power lambda. And here we are committing to we're implicitly committing to the assumption that this coefficient will be positive, whereas this coefficient will be negative, because an exponential can't change sign. Please. Yeah,
the RT term is not there because the reverse translation.
Where the what?
RT is R.
Dr dt. That's just a choice of coordinates. Coordinates. We've got two function. We've got two coordinate redefinitions left. Here we had a dr dt. When going from here to here, we get rid of the dr dt by using our two coordinate freedoms to set two conditions. Okay. The two conditions are: a, the radius is whatever appears behind d theta squared plus d phi squared, and b, the dr dt term is killed. Okay? Clear? Okay. So, now this is our form of the metric. Now, can somebody tell me, is there any further field redefinition ambiguity left here? A coordinate redefinition ambiguity left here? There is one. What? E to the power lambda is equal to what? Well, first, how do you set e to the power lambda equals 1? Lambda, in general, is a function of R and T. So you have to tell me what coordinate transform I can do. Can I redefine R? No, because R has physical meaning. Okay? Can I redefine T? Yes, nobody can stop me from redefining T. If I redefine it in a way that depends on R, then I'll generate a DTDR term. Okay? However, if I redefine in a way that depends only on T, all it'll do is change this new here. Okay? So we've got some coordinate freedom left. And the coordinate freedom effectively allows us to take nu to nu plus some function of T. Where that function is the logarithm of the derivative of the field, time field redefinition. Is this clear? Okay? So, two metrics that differ only by nu differing by function of T that are otherwise equal are the same metrics, just differ by a coordinate redefinition. We're not going to actually fix a coordinate choice for T just yet. We will do that in the solution as we get to it. Okay, but it's important to remember this at this point. Is this clear? Okay? With this kept in mind, we've now completely fixed coordinate freedom. You see, this is a lesson of how we work with general relativity. The formalism of general relativity is completely coordinate invariant. But to solve a given problem, you want to set up equations. Equations have to be set up in some coordinates. Sometimes mathematicians manage to solve problems without writing down equations in any coordinates. I don't understand how they do it. Okay, but physicists like equations that you can see. And you want to choose a particular choice of coordinates. So what you usually tend to do is tend to try to search for coordinates that are as well adapted to the problem as possible. Okay, suppose you worked in a completely coordinate invariant way. You said, I'll work with just arbitrary coordinates. Then, when you try to solve equations, you will find more solutions than physical solutions. Because in addition to having the solutions that you want, you will also have coordinate transforms of those solutions. Okay? And then you will have to disentangle which parts are physical and which parts are trivial. Okay? So it's often convenient to fix coordinate freedom in as good a way as possible at the beginning of a problem. Okay? Now we've done that. Now we have to solve Einstein's equations. Okay? So now... This is the painful thing. We're going just because it's the first time, we're going to do this quite explicitly in class. Okay, we're going to try to solve these equations quite explicitly in class. The painful part of this is to compute is computing all the Christoffel circles. But let's do it anyway. Okay. So we'll roll up our sleeves and start computing Christoffel circles. Okay. So let's first start with. Okay, let's use Landau-Lifshitz for guidance. Let's see which are the easiest ones. Okay, let's first do the Christoffel symbols that are purely in the sphere directions. Okay, so let's do gamma, theta, theta, theta. Okay, the metric is completely diagonal. So this is equal to g theta theta times theta derivatives of g theta theta. But that's zero. Because g theta theta has no theta. Okay. So this is equal to zero. What about gamma theta theta phi? Okay. This involves either phi derivatives of g theta theta or theta derivatives of g theta phi. There's no g theta phi. There's no phi derivative of g theta theta. So that's zero. So let's all the zeros we'll put in. So we've got clear that theta theta phi is equal to zero. Okay. Now let's look at gamma theta phi phi. Is this going to be zero? No. Because, exactly. There is a term which is, now let's be careful, minus half, I'll put the minus later, g theta theta times the piece that has the theta derivative of phi phi. That comes with a minus sign. Del theta of g phi phi. Okay. G phi phi was sine square theta times R square. So that's equal to 2, so the 2 cancels this. So sine theta cos theta R square with a minus sign. Okay, let's record. Let's see if we can get this the whole thing right ourselves. Okay, so we'll record this. Do you agree with me? If you first spot an error, please tell me. We'll also compare with Landau Lipschitz. Okay? And so this was gamma theta phi phi was equal to this. Okay, so now we've dealt. Okay, what about, let's do everything with a theta. Okay, so what about gamma theta tt? This is either involves, there's no t theta. This either involves a gtt with respect to theta, which is 0, or, well, or nothing else. So that's 0. Okay. What about gamma theta tr? Clearly 0. Okay. What about gamma theta? Now, the only non-zero. Okay, let's speed it up. What could be non-zero? With the theta, what could be non-zero? We've dealt with one thing here. Okay, there's one more thing that could be non-zero. What could it be? What? Somebody said theta r. You see, suppose we take gamma theta theta r, then that will involve a term that's an r derivative of g theta theta. Okay? This will be equal to, oh, and I forgot here, the g theta theta up. Oh, I put that right. No, g theta theta up. I messed up. Let me do this again. This one was g theta theta times minus half times del theta of g phi phi. Ah, so the r square cancelled. There's an r square in here and an r square in here, and that cancelled. So sorry. Okay. Now what about this guy? This guy has a g theta theta up, so that's a 1 by r square. So we get 1 by 2 r square times the r derivative of g theta theta. Which is minus 2r. Another thing we've messed up on is the sign. That was a minus, because g theta phi was minus. Yes. So minus 2r, so that is equal to minus 1 by r. Okay. So g theta theta r is minus 1 by r. Any other things with theta on top that could be non-zero? Okay, I don't think so. Because the only metric components involving theta that are non-zero are g theta theta, and then you need an r derivative. Or you could have a theta derivative and only phi phi. Okay, great. So let's rub these out. We've dealt with everything with theta on the top. Done. Now let's deal with everything with phi on the top. Which gammas with phi at the top could be non-zero? So firstly, anything involving a phi derivative is zero, because phi doesn't appear in the metric. Okay? So that phi has to be one of the metric components. The only metric component involving a phi is g phi phi. What does g phi phi depend on? It depends on theta and an r. So there are two things that could be non-zero. Okay. So there's gamma phi, there's phi r, and gamma phi phi theta. Okay, now let's compute this guy. So this guy, we need, firstly we have a g phi phi, then we have a plus half. Oh, aren't we messing up a lot? I'm gonna come back and look at the signs of these. But remember that the G inverses also have signs. We were messing up on that. I'm gonna come back and look at the signs of the top two ones again, but let's do this correctly. So there's G5 phi, there's a half, and then there is del R of G phi phi. Okay? So the signs cancel between these two. Okay? This thing is like R square. So the two factors, so this is 1 by R. Okay? Now I'm going to go back to the earlier ones, and this is 1 by R. Here it was minus, and here it was plus. Everything else cancels, right? Because we had G phi phi at the top, and then G phi phi at the bottom, differentiated with respect to R. So everything that doesn't depend on R cancels. So it's basically a logarithmic derivative of G phi phi with respect to R. The derivative of log G phi phi with respect to R. So that's a 1 by R. Okay. Now what about this guy? Here it's very similar, except that what we're differentiating is the sine square theta. Right? So we get sine theta cos theta divided by sine square theta. The cot theta. With no sine, I believe. Tell me if you agree with this. Cot theta. Okay, excellent. Let me now just check against Landau-Lipschitz. Three, two, three. Three is presumably phi. Three, two, three is cot theta. Good. But he doesn't have a 3. Sorry, just 1 minute. 3. Three, three. I suppose it's 1. 3, 3, 1. He doesn't report 3, 3, 1. I think he's just messed up. Okay, he doesn't report it. He says all the rest are 0. This is not zero, right? Okay, it's probably a mess up. We'll see. Okay, and let's check these two. So this is what he calls 2. So 2, 3, 3, does he have 2, 3, 3 at least? 2, 3, 3. Minus sine theta cos theta, excellent. And 2, 2, 1. 2, 2, 1 is 1 by R, excellent. Okay, so apart from hopefully his rather than our mess up, with this guy, we agree with that. Now let's continue. Okay, so we've done everything with an angular coordinate on top. Now let's take the things with R on top. Okay, so gamma R. Now it's more complicated because everything depends on R. Okay, so R could be either the derivative or it could be the metric. So, suppose we want the terms that are non-zero because R is the derivative. There are many such things. There's gamma R, R, R. Okay. There's gamma R, T, T. There's gamma R, phi, phi. There's gamma R, theta, theta. Let's get all of these. So, let's look at this first. So, this thing is is plus half G, R, R, del R, G, R, R. Right? So that is equal to, now GRR was minus e to the power lambda. The minus cancels between the two. So this is equal to lambda prime by 2. Okay. So prime, by prime I will mean R direct. Lambda prime by 2. Okay. When we do our next problem in class, I will just write down Christoffel symbols, okay? Okay, but once we'll calculate them. Okay. What about gamma? Or then there's TT, for instance. Okay. In this case, it's minus, this is equal to minus half GRR times del R of GTT. Okay. Now let's get the signs carefully. This guy comes with a minus, but this guy has a plus. So the minus goes away. Okay. So this is equal to e to the power nu minus lambda into nu dash. By 2. Okay. So e to the power nu minus lambda into nu dash by 2. Dash is derivative with respect to R. Okay. What about gamma R theta theta? Okay. So that is G R R times del R of G theta theta with a minus half. Okay. So that is equal to e to the power minus lambda, the minus signs between these cancel, so there's a minus here, R by just R. R times e to the power minus e to R e to the power minus lambda. Okay. The minus sign goes away? No, I don't think so. There were three minus signs. There was a minus sign for the inverse metric, the minus sign for the metric, and the minus sign because we're using the minus part of the gamma. Okay. And there was gamma R phi phi. This is extremely similar. It's just that you multiply this by sine square theta. Okay, but we're not even through with the... Oh, are we through? Let's see. I think we're through, maybe. So all that remains, we've taken into account all terms that come about because we're taking R derivatives with an R on top. But there are also the terms that could come about because we're differentiating a part of the metric which has an R index. The only part of the metric that has an R index is GRR. Ah, so there's one more term. What could it be? No, but yeah. So it could be RRT. Because GRR depends on T. Right? What could that be? So that could be plus half GRR into del T of GRR. Signs cancel. And so this is equal to half lambda dot. Where dot means derivative with respect to time. Okay, great. So we've dealt with everything involving an upper R. All that remains are things that involve an upper T. That's actually easier than upper R because the angular coordinates, the coefficient of that depends only on R square and not T square. Okay, so let's get the remaining guys. Okay, so there's gamma T T T, of course, which was equal to plus half GTT del T GTT, which is equal to, signs cancel, so it's equal to nu dot by 2. Full symmetry. Lambda prime by 2, nu dot by 2. Okay. Then, there was gamma T RR, which was equal to minus half GTT into del T GRR. Okay, which is equal to what? Exactly. So first the signs. This minus cancels a minus sign here. So it's plus. And the derivative is t derivative of RR. So it's lambda dot. So we get half e to the power lambda minus nu into lambda dot. Okay. Again, look at the symmetry between this and this. Flip under nu, R goes to T and nu goes to lambda. Okay. What about gamma T theta theta? Zero. Because G theta theta doesn't depend on T. Okay. Only remaining guy, there's one remaining guy. What could it be? Now, okay. We've dealt with all that come about because we're taking T derivatives. But what about the term with a T component? Exactly. This is the last non-zero guy. So what is it? It's plus half GTT into del R GTT. Okay. So that's equal to nu prime by 2. Okay. I suppose it's worth checking all these things. Yeah, it's probably worth checking all these. Okay. Fine. So let's see. So firstly, the guys with the 1 on top. So gamma 1, 1 is lambda prime by 2, correct? Gamma 1, 1, 0. 1, 1, 0 is lambda dot by 2 is... Oh. No, right. Gamma 1, 1, 0 is lambda dot by 2, correct? Gamma 1, 2, 2 is minus R e to the power minus lambda. 2, correct. Gamma 1, 3, 3 is minus R sine squared theta e to the power minus lambda, correct. And gamma 100, where is it? Gamma 100 is nu prime by 2 e to the power nu minus lambda, correct. Okay, so all that remains is this. So gamma 0, 1, 1, lambda dot e to the power lambda minus nu, correct. Gamma 0, 0, 0, nu dot by 2, correct. And gamma... TRT, so 0, 1, 0 we want, right? 0, 1, 0 is nu dot by 2. Perfect. So apart from the fact that Landau Lucius has one less gamma than we do, we've agreed with him completely. Okay, excellent. So now we know how we've computed all our Christoffelsons. Okay. But now in order to get Einstein's equations, we're not yet done. We need to compute curvatures. Okay. Now, if you were really working out a physics problem, you know, what you would do is to go to Mathematica. You'd find a package that takes a metric, computes curvatures for you, and that's what you would do. But, you know, once in your life, you should see how Mathematica does it. Okay.
In this one, deciding the sine of what is the sine of dt square and dl square, how do we do this fix?
Okay. So we're thinking of t as a time-like coordinate. Okay, so it's in flat space we would have had plus dt set. So we're looking at that by continuity. However, it's a very good question because as you will see in the black hole metric, this goes wrong at some point. So if you're near enough to being flat space, it can't go wrong. You know, because this was plus one. These were minus ones. Okay, so you have to be very far from the flat space metric in order for it to possibly go wrong. It does in some cases. But we'll ignore that possibility for now and correct for it when we can. It's a good question. By another choice of coordinates? But you see, it could be that the coefficient of dr squared, for instance, will become positive. Yeah, R is the thing, you know, R is physical. It's the thing behind the two sphere. And how do you know that that's the coefficient of that?
In this case, but in general,
uh-huh.
if DT term has a negative sign,
yes,
then it can be changed by HR.
Well, the signature of space-time cannot be changed. The fact is that it's 1 minus and 3 pluses cannot be changed. But of course, which one is minus and which one is plus, you can do just by renaming, right? If you call R, T and TR.
So in a black hole case, inside, does the signature change?
It doesn't, no, it doesn't change.
So, with the choice of coordinates, can I put the sign?
Well, you can choose to call what is R, you can choose to call it T. Okay? Except that then you'll have T squared behind the two-sphere metric. So once we fix coordinates like this, we've removed much of our coordinate redefinition ambiguity. And then the question of what the sign behind this term is, and what the sign behind this term is a physical question.
And these things
can flip physically. Okay? Good.
Coming from there to here.
Yes.
We have fixed P and A.
Yes.
And then we are also fixing the sign of P and R. So is it not
that
gamma goes to gamma plus
FP
is also
used? Gamma is what?
Nu.
No. So this doesn't change the sign. See, in an exponential, if you change a function, it doesn't change the sign.
But I'm putting it to the exponential form, we have not used any
freedom. Now, we've made an assumption by putting it to the exponential with this sign. You see, the most general thing was some function that could have been positive or negative. And we've given up some freedom by saying that this is an exponential because that fixes it to be positive.
That freedom,
like I said, is true in flat space.
I mean, function-wise, is it not used somewhere? Like, we had only four functions.
No, that's a discrete thing. It doesn't count as a function. It's an assumption. It's not a coordinate redefinition kind of freedom. We're assuming the metric is of the form that this thing is positive and these three are negative. And this is an assumption that is either true or false. And we will see when we solve our equations. At some point, the assumption will turn out to be false. In which case, we will have to do better. Okay? But we're not using some coordinate redefinition in B2G. It's a physical assumption. Okay. Okay, great. Other questions, comments? Okay. Now we want to sit and compute Einstein's equations. Okay. So, basically, in order to do that, we need the components of the curvature that are non-zero. Okay? Now, I'm not going to compute the zero ones for you. Okay? I'll leave that as an exercise. It's too exhausting to do that. Okay. But what I'm going to do is compute all the non-zero ones, all the ones that will give us our equations of motion. Okay. So, first I'll just list them. And I'll ask you to verify that you get nothing else. The ones that give you something, 0, R, 1, 1. So, what we call RR. R, TT. R, RT. Now, of course, once you know RRT, you can compute RTR, because once you lower, the Ricci tensor is symmetric. So there's also RTR, but I'm not going to write that because it's not new. Okay? And then you also have R theta theta and R phi phi. Okay? These are the only non-zero curvature Ricci components. This is a claim. Okay, maybe we'll check one that's not of this form at the end. But at the moment, I'm first going to sit and calculate these five components.
Do you have an interpretation for these components as R mu nu alpha beta gamma? I know how to interpret them as parameters.
There's probably something to say about this, but I don't know. I don't have. There's no way I think of it like that. There probably is someone who has a good way of thinking of it. I don't know. Okay. Good. So, now, let me start by computing, for instance, RR. Okay? Now let's remember what this thing is. Okay. So it was, in terms of gammas, it was gamma, firstly R, let's see. So firstly, let's write it in terms of R's. Riemann. So it was gamma, we'll contract first and third. And get second and fourth. Or maybe we'll contract second and fourth. Okay. Whatever. Okay. So suppose we contract second and fourth. So we have A. And then you've got... so this is... We're going to contract second and fourth. R. Okay. That's what RR is. You can choose to contract either first and second or fourth. Okay. So, now, this is equal to RA RB GBA. Okay. Now we want to know what this guy is. So what was it? This was... gamma R A, then B comma R, we got the sign right this time, minus gamma R A R comma B. Okay, plus gamma R A alpha gamma alpha VR or RB, yeah, RB, doesn't it? Just 1 minute, let me... Yeah. Just 1 minute. Possibly. Let me just remind myself first. A, B, C, D is what? The other terms are, it's gamma times gamma. So, this gamma, so gamma C, A, B, gamma D, sorry. Hello? Hi. Yes? Yes, yes, yes. Sorry, just 1 minute. Hi, Jagdish, I'm teaching a class now. I'll call you in the afternoon. Okay, thanks, bye. So this is how it goes, right? Sorry. So it's gamma C, A, gamma C A theta, gamma D theta B, minus gamma D A theta gamma C A theta B. Excellent. So, yeah, so that's the rule. Let me write this down again now. So it's, this was, sorry about this, people. So this is R A, what was this? B. Okay, so we get gamma B times gamma R, gamma R. Wait, sorry, this it was this thing. So gamma R gamma B minus gamma B gamma R. And then we have to put in the indices. So that's R C C A R C C A. Okay, I think I finally got it right. Do you agree? So it's gamma R gamma B minus gamma B gamma R in the sense of matrix multiplication, and these are the matrix indices. So R and A, R and A, and C C C C. Okay, fine. So this is the formula for gamma R R. For this thing, and then of course we've got to take this whole thing and contract it with GBA. Sorry, people. Hello? Hello? Haan, haan, boliye. Haan, haan. Andrade workshop wali mein. Leke gaya hoon. Haan, gayi hai. Thanks, bye. Sorry. It's the insurance for my car. Okay, excellent. So now let's compute this guy. Okay, so firstly, let's look at these two terms. All terms are a gamma R. Okay, this one is gamma R, and we have an R derivative of it. Okay, and we've got AB, so these two have to be the same. So what gamma R's depend on R? Okay? Well, all of these depend on R. But these two have to be the same. So all four of these contribute. Okay, painful, painful. Okay. Right, so... okay, so let's write it down. So we, from here, what do we get? We get G R R gamma R R R R plus G T T gamma R T T gamma R plus G theta theta gamma R theta theta R plus G phi phi comma phi phi comma R. That's this term. That's it. We've completely dealt with this term. We'll put in what these are. Okay. What about this term? Now, this term has a gamma R R. And the derivative has to be with respect to whatever's here. So that's much fewer terms. What it could be is gamma R R and an R derivative. Okay? So one term there is minus, and then this would be GRR. GRR gamma R R R comma R, which is going to cancel with this. Okay? And the other term that it could be is... this guy. Okay? So if we had that guy, this would be T, so this would have to be T. Okay? So we would have plus GTT gamma R TR comma T. Okay, so we've dealt with this guy and this guy. What remains are these two guys. Okay. So now let's look at this guy. This guy is gamma R and R something. Okay? So the only option is either C is R or C is T. But let's look at the case C is R. If C is R, then this guy is gamma R. And we have A equals B. And that's a lot of possibilities. Okay, so we get plus gamma R. Gamma R with a GRR. Plus gamma R, okay, let's keep gamma RR out common. Okay, I'll rewrite this. So that's plus gamma RR times GRR gamma RR plus GTT gamma RTT plus G theta theta comma R theta theta plus G phi phi comma R phi phi. That was this term when C was R. The other possibility is that C is T. Okay, if C is T, then and we want both equal, then the only thing that it could be is TT or RR. Right? So we get gamma R. No, still with a plus. So plus GRR gamma RRT gamma TRR plus GTT gamma RRT gamma TTT. Okay, that's dealt with this term. Now we want this term. Okay, let's look at that term. In this term, what do we have? We've got one R at the top and one R down there, and then these two are the same as these two. Okay. So now we're going to ask, what are the possibilities for these pairs? Because B and A are contracted, right? Yeah, so B is the same as A. Okay, sorry about this, we're almost getting there. Maybe we won't, wow. Okay, I think we will possibly have the strength to compute one of these curvature. let's see. Okay, so now BC and BC have to be the same. Now that restricts possibilities a lot. Let's see. One possibility, of course, is BC and CA, that they're both R's. Okay, so we get minus gamma RRR, gamma RRR, and then the GRR is upstairs. What other possibilities do we have? Let's see. One possibility, let's exhaust the RTs first. What about RT? That's a possibility, right? So suppose B is T and C is R. Okay. So we get minus, if B, so GTT gamma RT R gamma R RT. B is, we did B is T and C is R, but what about B is R and T is C is T? That's also a possibility. And that will give us minus, so gamma RR, gamma RRT gamma t r r. Okay, what about b, c are both t's? B and c are both t. That's also possible. So minus gamma r, b and c are both t, so t t, gamma t r t g t t. What? Say more clearly, I don't understand this.
C term.
This term?
Yeah, like C can be
dr for gr. I understand, but we're looking at cases one by one. We've looked at the possibilities for B and C being between R and T. Okay. Now what remains? Now we have to involve at least one angular coordinate. But there's never anything that has one angular coordinate. You have at least two angular. If you have one angular coordinate, you have two. Right? Okay, so B and C could take various combinations of the angles. Okay. So, were you saying that RR, what were you saying?
I was just collecting GRR terms together.
The terms we already written? No, are you saying we missed some terms?
Two more terms with GRR.
Which are these?
RR theta, gamma theta.
No, just say in terms of C.
Gamma R.
This is R, what is B going to be? RR.
I see.
Which is theta? No, C is, these two are equal.
C is theta.
B is, then B is also theta?
B is theta.
I see.
B and A are R and C is theta.
B and A are R and C is theta. This is R, R, theta. How is that non-zero? I don't think there's anything left. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So all that remains is that, I'm sorry about this, people. This is a very boring class, I know. But okay. But let's finish this. Okay. Right. So all that's left is BC and CA are both angular coordinates. Okay. So what we get left is gamma R, let's say theta, gamma theta R theta G theta. Okay. Now, what are the other possibilities? The other possibilities are gamma R. Okay. Suppose B is theta, C is phi. Is that non-zero? That's not non-zero. So we can forget about it. Suppose B is phi, C is theta. That's not non-zero. So the other possibility is B and C are both phis. Right? So we get phi, gamma, phi, R, phi, G, phi. Okay, it'll be absolutely a miracle if we get this right. I'm going to try for 5 minutes and let's. We may have to. This one? Okay, good. Firstly, was this GTT? And this had a minus sign. Let me see, where did it come from? It comes from the second term from here. Yeah, and therefore, since every term from the second term had a minus sign. Okay, now the first thing we're going to try to do is to cancel terms if we can. Okay, so these two we cancel. And out of the terms with derivatives involving gamma r, what about this one? Tr.
I suppose this was r, right?
Rtr. No, okay. So now in this line, this, and this, nothing cancels, right? Okay. What remains is all these product terms. So now let's look at the product terms carefully. Firstly, gamma rr, gamma rr, grr. This term cancels with this term. Okay, what about GRR, gamma RTR, gamma TRR? GRR, gamma RTR, gamma TRR. Beautiful, this cancels this. Okay, I suppose this was GTT. So what about GTT, gamma RTR, gamma TTT? GTT, gamma RTR, gamma TTT. GTT, gamma RTR. It doesn't look like there's anything to cancel that. Okay. Anything else that could potentially cancel here? Okay, let's organize terms. Let's write down the terms, organizing them, and then we'll see if they... if they cancel or not. Okay. So first the second derivative terms. Let's put up this board. Okay, so the second derivative terms are GTT gamma RTT comma R plus G theta theta gamma R theta theta comma R plus G phi phi gamma R phi phi comma R minus GTT T gamma RTR comma T. Okay, so those are the second derivative terms. Now we get the product of first derivative terms. Anything with a gamma RRR? Anything else with a gamma RRR anywhere? No. Right, so all terms with a gamma RRR will write. So gamma RRR times GTT gamma RTT plus G phi phi theta theta gamma R theta theta plus G phi phi gamma R phi phi. Great. So that's dealt with this term. Now, let's see. Have I put this term there? Yes. Okay. So now what remains is this term and the remaining terms here. Okay, so we'll do the ones without angular coordinates first. So all of these have GTTs, right? GTT, GTT, GTT. So plus GTT into gamma RRT, gamma TTT, minus G gamma RTR, gamma R RT minus gamma RTT gamma T RT. Okay, and then what remains? That's this and this. So, minus gamma R theta theta gamma theta R theta G theta theta minus gamma R phi phi gamma phi R phi G phi phi. Okay. So we've got at least a one blackboard expression for this one thing. I should have computed an easier one. This is the toughest one because R appears everywhere. Okay, so I should have started with an angular one. It's a bit easier. Okay, now we have to collect these things. Okay, is it worth it? On the other hand, what was the point of doing this if we don't do it? Okay, let's try, okay? I'm sorry, 10 minutes more. Okay. So, now I'm just going to try to write down what these things are. So that, people help me with this. Gamma RTT, R. Okay, so that's e to the power nu minus lambda. Okay, maybe it's not worth it. Okay. It looks like it'll take till the end of the class. And how about I ask you to compute this guy? Oh, the problem sets, by the way, are ready. Umesh will email it to you. The first problem set has 13 problems. That sounds like a lot, but they're not difficult. You know, they're not difficult, so they'll be emailed to you today. Okay, how about I ask you to complete this computation, to correct and complete this computation in a problem set. Okay, from now on, either we've done it wrong, in which case we'll never be able to fix it here, or we've done it right and okay, then you'll have an easy time in your problem set. I'm going to retreat to that. I'm sorry. Maybe there's some value to this because you see what there is to do. You also see it's tough to do. Okay. Yeah. So sorry. It's just too time consuming. I hadn't realized it would take this long. We'll just retreat. We'll retreat past this to say somebody has done this calculation. Mathematica can easily do it. I'm going to give you the answers. Okay, it's a mindless algebraic procedure. I'll give you the answers. Okay. So the answers go this way. So Einstein's equations, when you work them out, basically, actually, maybe there's an easier way. Just 1 minute. You know what's really irritating is that Landau Lipschitz says a simple calculation gives. Okay. Okay. Maybe they have cleverer ways of doing it than we do. Okay. But fine. So the Einstein equations work out to the following: 8 yk divided by c we're not keeping, trr is equal to minus e to the power minus lambda nu prime by r plus 1 by r squared plus 1 by r squared. This is one equation. Okay. The second equation is 8 pi k t22 is equal to 8 pi k t 22, that's theta theta. The phi phi is equal to, yeah, minus half e to the power minus lambda into nu double prime plus nu prime squared by 2 plus nu prime minus lambda prime by r minus nu prime lambda prime by 2. Plus half e to the power minus nu lambda double dot minus lambda dot squared by 2 minus lambda dot nu dot by 2. Okay, this is two of the equations. Then we also get an equation from t 8 pi k. T 0, 0 is equal to minus e to the power minus lambda 1 by r squared minus lambda prime by r plus 1 by r squared. And the fourth, the last equation, is that 8 pi k t 1 0 is equal to minus e to the power minus lambda dot by r. You know, what I could do if you want, what I could do is email all of you a package on Mathematica. Okay, I'll do this. This is actually more useful than actually working it out. I'll email you a package in Mathematica and ask you to use that to compute these equations, and you submit the Mathematica printout along with you. Okay, so this will be part of your this will be in your homework set. Okay, the package I'll email you is written by a guy called Matthew Hedrick, who was my first PhD student. That's a package I'm particularly familiar with. Okay, excellent. So now we've got these four equations, and they look like big complicated equations, and the first question is, what are we going to do with them? Okay, so I'm sorry, we're hitting lunchtime, I know, it's 10-15 moments when we finish this. Okay. No, we want the equations on the board. So, and we want to dust. Okay, I'm clearing this part. So Umesh, we promised, I don't think you were there, we promised to email them Math Tensor. And one of the problems in the assignment would be to get these equations using Math Tensor. Okay, great. Now what do? You see, what we want to do is take these equations and solve it in the simplest situation. So the simplest situation is when there is no stress tensor, no matter stress tensor out. Just the vacuum. So let's first solve it in that situation. Okay? So then, in that situation, the left-hand side of all equations is zero. So now let's look to see if we can find a particularly simple equation. Okay? This equation and this equation are particularly simple because they involve only lambda. What we want to solve for is lambda as a function of r and t. And nu as a function of r and t. Right? So we want to compute our metric. Okay?
The relation data, this will be lambda at some
slice. Yeah. Now, It's a good question. The initial data will in general be lambda and nu as a function at some initial point in RNT. We'll examine that in more detail. But so we're going to encounter something very interesting. That is that the solution is going to be unique in the absence of matter. So that it will not, you know, it's going to be like the fact that in a spherically symmetric potential. There are no spherically symmetric waves, basically. There are no spherically symmetric spin 2 waves. Okay, it's something that you're familiar with even in electromagnetism. If you've got a completely spherically symmetric distribution of charge, no matter how it's falling in, no matter what the charge is doing, the outside is basically given by the Coulomb field. If you preserve spherical symmetry, we're going to encounter something like this. In this situation. So we will not have to answer your question until we start looking at infalling, collapsing matter to form black holes. In which case we will return to your question.
So what is wrong with having no matter and choosing a given function?
Well, the only functions that will obey the spherically symmetric ansatz and solve the equations, it will be uniquely determined. Let's solve the equations that we see. Okay. The first equation we look at is this one. This tells us that lambda dot is 0. Therefore, we conclude that lambda is equal to lambda of r. Okay. The next equation we look at is this one. This equation now is just an ordinary differential equation in lambda. First order ordinary differential equation. And is quite easily integrated. Okay. So let's write down what the equation is. So the equation is e to the power minus lambda 1 by r squared minus lambda prime by r plus 1 by r squared is equal to 0. What?
Minus 1 by r squared minus.
Thank you. Okay, we'll return to this equation in a moment. But even before that, let's also look at this equation. This is also a pretty simple equation. And I'll write it below it. It's that minus e to the power minus lambda of nu prime by r plus 1 by r squared plus 1 by r squared is equal to 0. Okay? So even before integrating any particular equation, let me take these two equations and subtract them. You see, in subtracting them, this term cancel, and this term and this term cancel. Okay? So what we get is e to the power minus lambda, and that we can throw away since it's overall common outside, is basically we get lambda prime minus nu prime is equal to 0. Is this clear? Okay. Now, since we get lambda prime minus nu prime equals 0, we can integrate this equation to get nu is equal to lambda plus a function of t. But you remember we had a residual coordinate invariance that allowed us to shift nu by a function of t. T coordinate redefinitions. We'll use that freedom to set this function to 0. So we'll choose our coordinates so that nu is equal to lambda. Our remaining field redefinition ambiguity, our coordinate redefinition ambiguity, is used up in this manner. Okay? So, we conclude very simply that nu is equal to lambda and both of them are functions only of r. Notice we have not assumed that the problem is static. We have not assumed that things aren't moving. You know, so what are we doing? We've got, we're solving this problem in a region where there's no stress tensor. But there could be stress tensor somewhere else. You could have a cloud of dust, say, that's collapsing. But as long as it's spherically symmetric, where there is no dust, we have concluded that nu is equal to lambda, and both of them are functions only of R. So we've got an essentially static solution. Okay, this is the statement that there are no spherically symmetric gravitational waves, basically. Okay? And, of course, we presume spherical symmetry. Okay. Now, what remains is to solve the equation. So let's take this equation. Okay. So we've got an equation that we want to solve, and that's easy to solve because we can linear first order differential equations can always be solved by integration. Now you might think this is not a linear first order differential equation because it's got a complicated dependence on lambda, but that's a fake. Let's move to the variable e to the power minus lambda. Okay, so this thing is minus e to the power minus lambda by r squared, and then we had minus and minus, but I'll make it so minus e to the power minus lambda prime by r, okay, plus 1 by r squared is equal to 0. Okay, so that's pretty simple. So now such an equation can always be solved by integrating factors, and it's actually a very simple solution here. So let's just multiply this whole equation through by r squared. So we get an r here. And now we recognize that this is simply r times e to the power minus lambda prime with a minus. Is equal to minus 1. So we conclude that r e to the power minus lambda prime is equal to 1. Okay? And therefore, r times e to the power minus lambda is equal to r plus c by integration. And therefore, e to the power minus lambda is equal to 1 plus c by r. And I'll write minus c for reasons that we'll soon be up here. So the physical case will be c is positive. Okay. So, what is our solution? Our solution, even though we had to cheat, I'm sorry, to get it, is ds square is equal to, now, dr squared was multiplied by e to the power lambda, so we get 1 minus c by r, minus sign, minus r squared d theta squared plus d phi squared. Okay. Minus sine squared theta. Plus dt squared in 1 plus 1 minus. Because nu is equal to minus. This is a unique solution. I mean, there's one parameter ambiguity from this constant C. But it's otherwise a unique solution of general relativity in the absence of matter assuming spherical symmetry. Okay? This plays the role of the unique Newtonian potential of a spherically symmetric mass distribution. Outside the mass, the potential falls off like 1 by r. In fact, it reduces to that in the Newtonian limit because we wanted to identify this thing as 2 phi. So c by r should be identified as, twice c by r should be identified by as m by r. Okay, or maybe Km by R because it's Newton's constant. Okay, so this tells us that it's natural to replace this C by Km by. No, sorry, I did this wrong. 2 phi, which is equal to 2 k m by r, should be identified with c by r. Minus 2 phi, which is 2 k m by r, should be identified with c by r. So c is equal to 2 k. Okay? At least in the Newtonian limit, this constant can be thought of as, so the metric you might want to write as, ds squared is equal to 1 minus 2k m by r dt squared minus dr squared over 1 minus 2k m by r plus r squared d theta squared plus sine squared theta d phi squared.
When we were solving this equation, what went into the thing was that it has no matter and it's very basic. But what we get out is some sort of velocity.
You see, suppose you've got a situation like the sun, where there's matter inside, but nothing outside. What we've done is accurately solve for the metric outside where there's matter.
Basically, you can't have spherically symmetric solutions in a total absence of mass.
Yeah, that every spherically symmetric solution other than the vacuum has a mass sitting at the center, somehow or the other. We turn to this question more as we go on. But one thing about this is that we've identified this m by as the mass only with analogy with the Newtonian limit, and that could be wrong. It could be a nonlinear function of this m. Okay? However, this analogy actually gave us the right answer. As I had planned to discuss today, but I'm sorry, hijacked by the stupid algebra, I should never have warranted.
One analogy we can make is that we are flipping the TR signs for a given radius.
What? I didn't answer.
Your dt squared dr squared
sign. Flip when you go past a particular area. That's a good point. However, in many real objects like the sun or the earth, that radius happens well within where there is matter. So this doesn't have to happen. But just let me say that we'll start next time's class by sometime in next time's class, I will explain to you that general relativity does come equipped with a conserved energy and a conserved momentum. This is something we have not really seen yet. Okay? And that the energy of and momentum of a space-time can be measured by doing some integral at infinity. It's called the ADM energy and the ADM momentum. Okay? And doing that integral at infinity for the space-time will identify the energy as M. So writing in this way correctly identifies M as the energy of the space-time. The conserved energy of the space-time. We will see that. We haven't yet seen this.
Gravitational waves are present.
So have some energy? Yes. 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 Yes.
Energy for a wave though.
Yes. In general relativity, there is no gauge invariant way, no coordinate invariant way of localizing energy. However, the question of what the energy of a space-time is completely unambiguous.
That depends on your time.
Okay. All time coordinates that reduce to the same thing. So, as we will see when we do this, we will make the following assumptions. We're dealing with a space-time that is completely arbitrary, but at asymptote, at infinity, becomes flat. Okay? Now, at infinity, then we'll adopt a canonical t coordinate. Any choice of coordinates which reduces to the same canonical choice at infinity will give you the same answer for h. So we'll use some metric that at infinity reduces to the Minkowski space metric in standard Minkowskian coordinates. Okay? That's the only thing we will assume about a coordinate system. And then, with that assumption, we will get a well-defined energy that will not depend on your choice of coordinates. Yes?
The solutions we have found out for mirror and diagonal.
Yes.
Those are found out from first and final two equations.
Yes.
But those also should be consistent with that t theta theta d phi phi.
Excellent question. Excellent question. Yes.
And in the bracket, that new prime minus lambda prime term goes to 0, and new prime square and new prime lambda prime, those two terms cancel. But new double prime term is remaining there, and that does not be useful.
Oh, so you say that this does not work out? Let's see. Firstly, everything here involves dots. So this is just 0. Now, nu prime minus lambda prime is 0. Here, nu prime lambda prime remains.
But that cancels out with nu prime.
And that cancels out with nu prime square. No, it adds. Because there's a minus. And nu is minus lambda.
No,
nu is lambda. Wait. I did something wrong somewhere. Our metric had one on top and one at the bottom. Let's subtract. I just wrote this wrong. Nu is minus lambda. Right, our metric had this thing and this thing inverse. I just wrote that. Okay, now let's check. So, what you want is that... So we had lambda. Okay. So where did we have our lambda? Yeah. We had e to the power minus lambda was equal to 1 minus c by r. So lambda was equal to minus log of 1 minus c by r. Okay. And nu was equal to plus log of 1 minus c by r. So these two terms here are just, for instance, lambda prime or nu prime, it doesn't matter. So let's say nu prime squared, those added up. And so we got 1 over 1 minus c by r into derivative of minus c by r, which is equal to c by r squared. And this thing, the whole thing, square. Okay. What about this guy? So, let's simplify this. So that's equal to c square by r to the 4, 1 minus c by r, the whole thing, square. Now let's compute nu double prime. Nu double prime, right? So the first prime we had, so that was c by r squared over 1 minus c by r. Okay. And let's write this as c divided by r minus c, the whole by r. Okay. Now I'm going to differentiate. So... what do we get? Differentiating gives 1 by r squared, r minus c, the whole thing squared, with a minus into the derivative of this guy, which is 2r minus c. Doesn't look like the same.